Hello everyone, welcome to our Let's Play series of Hard West. This is Colonel RPG as usual, and I'm very happy that you chose to join me today as we continue helping Cassandra, or playing as Cassandra, and trying to apparently get rid of her precognition, which she doesn't have right now because she needs to sleep. So where should I go though? Oh, let's see, Adelante. Adelante means ahead, which is interesting. Why would a city be called ahead? Makes no sense. Anyway, we need to go to Army Fort right there, Gambling Den right there. We got Hacienda Garcia Pimentel, right there. That's a Portuguese, I know that's Spanish, but yeah, that's a Portuguese surname as well. So let's go to the hospital. Maybe we'll be able to sleep there? The only hospital in the region was housed in a Catholic mission and staffed by nuns. The Mother Superior greeted Cassandra and her companions warily, but told them she could tend to their wounds as required. Well, Cassandra asked whether the nuns had any medical supplies they could purchase. The Mother Superior explained that the only medication she had in large supply was the powerful laxative potion. She handed over a tall, dark green bottle with a label that promised its contents induced instant intestinal alacrity. Okay, so I'm not sure I'm gonna get any need for that. I was gonna make a dirty joke, but I'm not gonna do that. With a weary sigh, the Mother Superior asked whether they required anything else. Nope, they left the hospital. So we now have a laxative, which is gonna come in handy if ever we need to, I guess, relax our intestinal system. So let's go to this. Yeah, we're gonna be able to buy a lot of stuff. We should be able to buy a lot of stuff. Because we're gonna be dealing with a lot of money. So I'm not really sure how we're gonna gain that money. I expect it to be a mixture of random encounters, you know, not random encounters, but just, you know, interactions with the world and selling off some loot. But I don't know. We got the Doomsday Watch over here. That is a very good one. I really want that. Thank you. That was good. And not really. Not really. Mm-hmm. Got a hiccup out of that one. Ooh, a Cañón Calavera. What the hell is that supposed to be? Yeah, the N. It's a weird sound. The N with a tilde on top. It reads Cañón. Nya, nya, nya. Yeah, it's a very weird sound for those who are not initiated in the, I guess, Latin languages. Because, yeah, the French also has that, except it's not written like that. Portuguese is not written like that either. It's an N and an H after that, so that means nye. If it were French, it would be a G and an N. G N, and it'd be like champagne. There is quite a few interesting weapons around here. I am very interested in this one, because it deals 6 damage. That is, I want that. I want that very much. I also want this. Yeah, let's buy all. Buy everything! Who cares? Also, I want this! Buy everything! We have more. So rich. We are so. Also, that! Buy that! Oh boy, we're gonna put that! Buy that as well! What is that? Don't buy that. Okay, we're good. So let's pay with cash, because we are loaded. And now we're loaded for bear. We're loaded for bear, that's right. So let's see what we had here. Oh, I had a Cañón Cavalera here as well. Not sure what Cavalera means, though. That was kind of a bad investment on my part, I suppose. Maybe. Let's see, this one increases. Nah, it's not. It's crap. That one is crap. I don't need that one. I'm gonna put that one over there. Yeah, and what about this one? 6 shooter? That is crap. So I could go with a shotgun. Or I could go with this one. I could go with this one. Yes, I could. So I'm gonna go with that. I want low damage. Yeah, I want that as well. I want that as well, but I kind of would like the double thingy that she has, because I'm gonna give her this thing. What is it? It's this thing over here. So now that deals 5 damage, and this one deals 8. Yeah, that's gonna come in handy, hopefully. So let's see. You have that. It's gonna deal 7, and then you're gonna get a shotgun, maybe? Holy musket. Yeah, that would be interesting. Dealing 11 damage. That's kind of a waste, though. That's kind of a waste, so let's not give you that. Let's give you this one, and you are gonna take that one. So you are gonna be quite a high damage dealer, but you're gonna be very bursty because you need to reload as well. So if I had like a thing, let's see, grand healing over time, I don't need that. Let's use this one instead. And since you're gonna be at the back most of the time, we are good to go. So I can't rest right now, which is kind of a shame. Let's see if I can rest in Adelante. The bustling town of Adelante was full of new buildings and prosperous people. The copious construction work in town was sponsored almost single-handedly by Mr. La Fortuna, which is the guy that we're trying to find, I think. For the denizens of the Western Territory, La Fortuna was the embodiment of prosperity and modernity. So let's visit the general store. The general store is in Adelante offered a modest but adequate selection of goods. Okay, it's not adequate. I mean, it is. It is. I'm being unfair. Let's see what we can do here at the cantina. Cassandra was pleasantly surprised to find that the cantina appeared safe and well run. Okay, so let's do this first. Cassandra reviewed the latest headlines in search of any mentions of her misadventures. It seemed Cassandra had managed to keep a low profile so far. She found no mention of her adventures. Could it be that our heat increases our this thing? Hopefully not. Let's get a room. There you go. Now she's looking all devilish. She's always looking devilish. But anyway, Cassandra and her companions enjoyed a good night's sleep in a tidy single bedroom. The bartender nodded. It wasn't. I added that part. The bartender nodded to Cassandra and gestured toward the cantina's offerings. Well, let's go back to town. Ooh. Oh, now we can do this. This is good. Cassandra entered the cantina, and but no. Though she felt awkward and about making such a seemingly lowbrow request, Cassandra suggested that they find a local brothel. Why would I want that? Can I gain money there? Am I gonna be able to sell my sweet booty there? And by booty, I mean my loot. That's what I mean. When Cassandra told Hardin they should find the bordello, his eyes lit with an unsavory glow. She admonished him sternly, insisting this was strictly a business outing. Oh, of course, of course. Her head was already starting to ache. It was only a matter of time before it dulled with pain for hours or even days. They arrived at the brothel in time to witness a violent quarrel. An older, flamboyantly dressed woman beating an Indian prostitute with a billy club. What is a billy club? Cassandra guessed the older woman was the bordello's madam. Let's see. Ardeen stared at the scene, frozen for a moment, agog. An instant later, Ardeen rushed at the madam, landing a full force punch in the middle of her face with a crunch. As she sprawled out on the floor, dazed and screaming, Ardeen rushed the native woman, helping her up. She hugged him as she cried, covering him with kisses in a way that suggested that they had more than a passing familiarity with one another. Ardeen mentioned to Cassandra to get out of town, out of sight. She ducked into the nearest back street. Ardeen and his native acquaintance joined Cassandra as soon as they could. She wasted no time reprimanding Ardeen for attracting the attention of the entire town and doubtless the authorities. Ardeen explained that he had no choice. It was his duty to defend Felicia. Apparently they had known each other for some time. Cassandra guessed Ardeen was one of her regulars. Felicia apologized for the trouble, but said that without her job, she had nowhere to go. Ardeen suggested she could join Cassandra's posse, as she was a good shot and good company. Well, I guess that's okay. Cassandra knew accepting this woman into the team would attract unwanted attention, but decided to do it anyway. Yeah, since she's a good shot, I'm gonna take her. Felicia thanked Cassandra profusely and promised to be a valuable asset to the team. And we are back. Can I go back into the cantina and rest again? I have money, so let's do that. The bartender nodded, let's go back to town, and let's leave. Upon leaving Adelante, Cassandra was had an unnerving but all too familiar feeling, a powerful premonition that made her head ache for days on end. Okay, so what should I do here? I don't know. Let me think. So the game, so far, the game, when I was playing as the leader, the game has did not penalize me by if I used up my the madness thing that I was using, so it was all okay. After that, we got I don't know. I'm trying to read in between the lines of the game here. I'm trying to guess whether or not I should save that thing more or less. I'm gonna go with it. Cassandra gritted her teeth and allowed the premonition to take her. Her skull blazed with pain as the vision took shape. Cassandra saw a stagecoach loaded with expensive luggage against a gorgeous mountain backdrop. Suddenly, a vulture's cry split the air. She looked up and saw several haggard birds circling overhead. As her premonition faded, she looked around for landmarks. She was positive she could pinpoint the location of the vulture's feast. Okay, so that was good. Let's rest again. I'm not sure. This might be the big problem here, resting. And, yeah. Not sure. Okay, so yeah, that's good. I don't really have anything. I was thinking what I should. I'm going back to the hospital because I think there might be something interesting here. Nope, there's nothing. Okay, so maybe in the Fate Trader or something. Speaking of which, we have a new companion. Hello, she's very. Oh, it looked like wounds, but no, it's not wounds. It's just tattoos, I suppose. So let's see. We got a volcano pistol, which is pretty good. You have a seal head. A six shooter, and you're gonna get a Remy Borgen rifle. Let me see. You're not a good aim. You are a terrible aim, miss. You are a terrible, terrible aim. So let me give you that. Let's see what I have here for you. Not much. You might die. That's I'm afraid to admit it, but you might die. Actually, let me see. Do I have cards that I can? Nah. Okay, it's fine. Let's keep going then. Oh, by the way, let me see if she still has the massive amounts of defense. She does. Man, my God, 26 defense, 25. It's just. I don't even. Let's go here to the crash stage coach and see what we can do there. Following Cassandra's directions, the party soon arrived at the location of a stagecoach crash. The putrid smell of decay indicated the accident took place several days ago. A flock of vultures feasted on the well-heeled passengers. One of the birds looked up from its feast, fixing the company with a rheumy glare before slowly flapping skyward. Harding began rummaging through the pockets of the dead, whistling casually as though we were picking daisies. Cassandra, finding nothing of interest, was begging to regret coming, when she spied a thin leather suitcase sitting in the dust. Opening this case, she discovered a document written in dark blue ink on thick paper, adorned with official stamps and seals. It appeared to be the deed to a silver mine. Oh, somewhere in the Rockies. Cassandra pocketed it while her companion rummaged through the rest of the spoils, and they left. So what did we get here? We got a Remy Borgen rifle, got dried meat, we got a bottle of liquor, and that's about that. Okay, let's keep going then. Let's go to the gambling den. Actually, what is this? Pilgrimage. Okay. We're not getting money, by the way. Harding led Cassandra to the notorious outlaw gambling den. The venue was set up in a cliffside cave in an ancient Indian pueblo. There were no lights on the outside, but Harding pointed out two guards concealed against the crumbled walls next to a narrow entrance with a thick black curtain. Inside, they found a wide repertoire of gambling tables, an assortment of colorful, dangerous-looking characters, and an ample supply of liquor. As you'd expect, really. I'm not gonna risk that. I'm not crazy. Cassandra sat within hearing range of the drunken prospector and eavesdropped on his story. The prospector claimed to own a map to the wreck of an old Spanish treasure ship. Harding dismissed it as bragging, but Cassandra was interested. She probed what the man's future held. Her initial attempts were inconclusive. Cassandra felt she was already losing her lucky streak, but she went on. Cassandra saw the man severs. Oh, I can use. I can use it more. Oh, okay. Now I know how that works. Cassandra saw the man suffer a violent death. It thoroughly distressed her, but she obtained no useful information. She went on. As the searing pain pierced her brain, she saw the prospector lying dead in an old shipwreck, surrounded by piles of gold. As the vision faded, she managed to recognize a landmark that pinpointed three possible locations for the wreck. She came back to reality and nearly collapsed from the exhaustion. She left the premises to try and recover her strength. Let's go back to the... what was it? Adelante? Yeah, let's go down there. Because we need the treasure. Let's enter the cantina. What did I just do? I rested. That's what I double clicked. That's what happened. So let's leave. I think we should be good. So let's go down here to the derelict shipwreck and see what we can do. On its side in the shallows, the shipwreck looked like a beached whale. When Cassandra's team headed inside, they found it filled with dead bodies of its crew and passengers. The air was heavy with the stench of dead. Cassandra knew the dangers decomposing bodies presented. But she decided to search the cargo hold anyways. The cargo holds were filled with dark, scintillating rocks. Felicia became agitated, saying it was a pitch blend. Pitch black? Pitch blend? What? Saying it was What is that? Pitch black? The nausea-inducing, vitality-draining the natives called Curse Rock. She ran out, shouting for the others to do the same. Harding shouted at Felicia that she was a superstitious coward. She shouted back to Harding that was an overbold fool. Okay. Cassandra silenced them both. She opted to leave the ship. No, wait a minute. She ignored them as she looked for actual valuables. I think it all went well. Pretty sure all went well. Searching the dead was slow and taxing. Cassandra managed to find the captain's personal luggage. Along with some ancient photographs, Cassandra found a broken watch engraved with the name Franco Morales. It might be worth 100 pesos to a collector. She had resolved to look for more, but suddenly felt faint. After a brief moment of confusion, she fell to the ground unconscious. Yeah, that didn't go well. That did not go well. Cassandra awoke several hours later, nauseated and weak. Unable to travel, the company was forced to camp on the beach that day. Okay. That's fine, I guess. What did you get? Minus one AP? HP, I mean? Yeah, it's fine. You never get hit anyway, so it's totally cool. Even though I'm not gonna risk it with her. Anyway, let's go here to this one. On the sharp rocks... Oh, actually, I can go back to the hospital, and probably they are gonna be able to fix me. Maybe. On the sharp rocks of the bay that sat the decomposing wreck of a caravel, almost entirely disintegrated, they could barely make out the name on the ship, Luis... So that's Luis L5. What's that? Isn't that like 50? L, that's 3. What? 70! Oh, yeah, that's 77. Cassandra doubted it would yield much. Yeah, that's 50. That's. No, 87, sorry. That's 3. 3 X's, so that's. Yeah, 3 tens. She decided to search the wreck anyway. As he descended into the wreck, Harding stepped on a sea urchin and had to be helped, limping onto the shore. A closer inspection on the wreckage yielded an ivory comb and some golden teeth, worth 100 pesos or so. Harding suggested there might be more valuables at the bottom of the bay, but that obtaining them would mean contending with more dangerous sea fauna. Okay, let's send... let's send Paco down there. Cassandra's companion disappeared beneath the sparkling water. After a number of reconnaissance dives, the swimmer submerged for close to a minute before erupting to the surface holding a small ornate chest. Inside, Cassandra found a collection of ivory pieces. They would be worth at least 1,000 pesos to a collector. Good, good, good. Good, good, good. So what exactly... No, that's not... That was not... No, okay, there we go. What exactly did we get with this guy? Numb leg. That's fine. It's not... awesome, but it's okay. I don't really mind that much. The ancient wreck of a Spanish galleon set in a small cove and looked harmless enough. The name of the bow read Amaya Calvo. The air smelled of dried seaweed and mold. Okay, let's follow inside. Let's go inside. Descending into the cargo hold, the team found crates filled with valuables and expensive materials. Much of the treasure had decayed with time. However, a good portion of the silver and gold objects could be salvaged with a significant... With a significant amount of work, Cassandra decided they needed the money. Yes, we do. As the salvage continued, Harding became wary. He told Cassandra that the longer they stayed there, the better chance someone would arrive, perhaps to lay in wait and attack them once they had retrieved all the treasure. He suggested retreating with what they had now, rather than hope they could get away with everything. Nah, yeah, let's insist to retrieve the treasure in its entirety. The attack came at dawn. And what exactly happened? Paco was shot. But we got us, a king of spades, there we go. Cassandra and her companions fought valiantly, but the bandits still managed to injure some of the party. Paco was hit in the arm, the wound bled prodigiously. Worse still, the shots could be heard for miles. Cassandra cursed the thought that the authorities might be alarmed. Despite the injury, however, the team recovered all the loot on the ship. It totaled several thousand pesos at least. Oh! That was good that we had to do that. We definitely had to do that. Let's go there to the hospital and let's heal ourselves, I hope. Yeah, we needed to heal all of our guys. Oh, it's pretty cheap. Let's go with that. Everybody's gonna be fine. Yeah, there we go. Perfect. So everybody's now back up to full strength. Let's look at the cards, see what we got. We got plus sight. Not really something that I'm really interested in, if I'm honest. Let's see. Aim 55. Excuse me. I'm gonna give you this guy, I'm gonna give you that one. That's the barrage, so maybe she likes that one first. She deals so much damage, she's gonna be able to kill lots of people if she uses that one. Yeah, that's gonna be the end. That's gonna be, like, massive amounts of death right there. So, where do we want to go? Mexican Army Fort? Maybe. Let's go there, I guess. So. The team arrived at the Mexican army stronghold in the Western Territory. The terrain was challenging and progress had been slow. They were grateful for the respite. Harding offered to buddy up to the grunts. He said he'd see what they knew and maybe win some of their money. Okay, let's see what we could learn from the commander. Commander Alberto J. Barbola Barrueco greeted Cassandra gallantly and offered refreshments. He excused his humble surroundings, explaining that order was maintained in this region by the private militias of wealthy industrialists such as Ricardo La Fortuna. Consequently, the Mexican military had only a minor presence in this area. So his military is from the government. Okay. Cassandra asked how it was possible for someone like La Fortuna to blockade his competitor's assets. The commander told Cassandra that Mr. La Fortuna was a benefactor of the United Mexican States. Is that a thing? Really? Are there states in Mexico? I mean, I guess there are. Or they were, maybe, I don't know. The government trusted him and gave him many liberties. He explained that the blockade Cassandra had referred to was only a training exercise for his merchant fleet, put on in response to the rise of piracy in the Caribbean. Okay, rumbling noises and jeering voices from outside caught the commander's attention, though. He got up from his desk and looked through the window, Cassandra joining him. Harding was quarreling with a soldier. The commander excused himself, leaving Cassandra in the room alone. Okay, so we could search the files. Yeah, I don't care about my own exploits. I want... maybe I do. I don't know. This one. Cassandra found a small key and used it to unlock the commander's drawers. Along with a collection of letters, a standard issue gun, and some ammunition, she found one truly interesting item, an army requisition form. It would almost certainly prove useful in the future. No one would miss it here. She stole the requisition form. Cassandra could hear the commander's steps in the corridor. She hastily closed everything and leapt back into her seat. The commander walked in, visibly upset. He explained Arden had got into trouble playing dice, but that he would... What happened here? I didn't see what that was. But he would overlook it, as his soldiers shouldn't have engaged in gambling in the first place. Still, he said Cassandra and her crew should leave immediately and not return. Okay, she curtsied and gracefully and left. Harding's bruised countenance, so he got loaded dice, told the tale of his gambling adventure with the soldiers. As they left, he told her that he had won some money, but more importantly, he'd acquired a pair of loaded dice. In Cassandra's skilled hands, any dice would now be less of a gamble. And we are still not at 25,000, but we got... Let's see what we have here. Loaded dice. Did he get... was it Harding? It was Harding. He didn't get any... Yeah, it's good. He wasn't bruised or anything. I was kind of afraid for the guy. So these are done. Let's go up here. I guess we only have these two locations left. Let's see. Yeah, I think so. Let's go here to the Hacienda García Pimentel. I'm putting on my best Spanish accent. It's not very hard for me. Matron, I'm not Spanish, by the way. I say this sometimes. Anyway. Matron Pulqueria Adelmira García Pimentel. That's, yeah, us here. I guess it might be, well, over here in Portugal and in Spanish, in Spain as well, but I guess Italians do as well, and French people as well. We don't have, we have many names. My name is even longer than this one, for example. Yeah, we have many names, and I know for a fact that over in the Nordic countries they also have many names. So yeah, that's the thing. So let's see. Matron was one of the last of the venerable García Pimentel clan, which had flourished in the New World for hundreds of years. Now, the family was a shadow of its former glory, but García Pimentel Library remained the greatest and most complete collection of works detailing the New World and the rise of Mexico. Madame Matron, I don't know, García Pimentel jovially greeted Lydia, as Cassandra had introduced herself, and guessed she was here to see the fabled library. Well, yes, I am. Let's see, though she had little idea of the contents or usefulness of the library. The matron nodded and led them inside. There, they were joined by a scrawny figure in clothes that had been very fine, but were clearly showing their wear. Matron García Pimentel said this was her son, Porfirio, and that he would he would be their guide to the library. Cassandra curtsied, taking a closer look at the young man. On top of the hunched, scrawny body sat a large head with a bulging lump in the middle of his forehead. It doesn't even sound like he's alive. What the hell is wrong with this guy? His skin was mottled and unnatural looking. He inclined his head slightly at all times. Okay, I guess she suppressed the shiver. As they walked into the library, Porfirio told Cassandra about various landmarks in the area, spouting an endless stream of historical facts, interrupted only by his slight stutter. Although at first he seemed consumed by his studies of history, Cassandra soon realized his trembling hands, darting eyes, and blush meant something completely different. He was attempting to court her. In another context, it might have been endearing, but she was unsettled by the cold lump she felt in her stomach. Porfirio broke her reflections, asking whether there was anything in particular she would like to hear about. She pretended to be interested in whatever he deemed worthy of attention. According to Porfirio, the Calaca Shrine was the crown jewel of the area's historical attractions, believed to have been built long before the first Europeans set foot in the New World. It contained several painted skulls, sculptures called Calacas that inexplicably bore ancient Christian symbols, fish, crosses, and various three-cornered ornaments. The shrine was considered by many of the as the ultimate confirmation that Christianity was the world's one true religion. There had been a minor military struggle over who controlled it, with the winner doing their utmost to camouflage its position. When they met their downfall, however, its precise location was lost to history. At this last sentence, Porfirio's deformed lips twisted with what Cassandra interpreted as an approximation of a smile. Man, this guy's creepy. She had guessed aloud that she knew so much. She was sure he must know the location. The young man looked away shyly. When Cassandra pressed, he nodded his deformed head in confirmation. He said he would tell Cassandra the location in exchange for a kiss. Oh, yeah. Let's see. Oh. Okay, so will she do that with that one? Nah, I guess so. I guess let's go with this one. Fighting her revulsion, she brought herself to lay a gentle kiss where a person's cheek would be. This guy is deformed like hell, man. At the last moment, Porfirio turned his head and Cassandra found herself kissing his lips. Then he grasped her head to his and forced his tongue into her mouth. Okay. Well, let's see. Should we play along? I don't know. I need the money. Oh boy. This is gnarly. Okay. Anything, whatever. I don't know. I'm gonna go with this one. Cassandra weathered the ordeal. She even managed to let out some falsely contented murmurs to cloud his judgment. He looked at her, enamored and awestruck. Yeah, I don't know who had the worst one of this, him or her. Yeah, this is a messed up situation right here. As Cassandra battled the urge to hold her breakfast, he produced the detailed map of the area from a desk drawer and pointed out the exact location of the shrine. He then copied the major landmarks onto a piece of paper and gave it to her. It was more than she could have hoped for. Okay, let's leave then. Cassandra's heart sunk when she reached the foyer to find Hardin, unconscious, on a chaise longue. Lady Garcia Pimentel explained that she had left the group alone with a bottle of brandy and returned to him to find him like this. She suggested that Cassandra and her friends stay the night and leave the next morning. I think Cassandra felt a dawning premonition and allowed herself to focus on it. Cassandra felt a great danger emanating from the Garcia Pimentel house that extended far beyond kissing disfigured men. In a blink, she had a vision of herself in a bridal gown that was slick with blood. She blinked, and the feeling passed, leaving a painful throbbing in its place. I'm out of this place. I'm really out of this place. Cassandra insisted they needed to leave immediately. Nobody stopped them. And I think that's going to be the end of this episode as well. We got a Queen of Diamonds. Isn't that the one, the unholy power or whatever? What? Oh, Shadow Cloak. Yeah. Oh, boy. She's a mean girl. Look at that. Man, Jesus. That's plus movement. That is going to come in handy for... who has least movement? That's going to be you, right? Yeah, it's you. So you go with that. And now you have plus one elf per turn. That's pretty good. Although you only have... How the hell do you only have 19 luck? Oh, because... Oh, minus one disgust. That's fine. The hospital will cure that. And you're drunk. Damn you. But that's not... That doesn't account for the lack of luck. Yeah, these guys are not that very lucky. So I think I'm gonna go back to the hospital. And I'm gonna end the episode with that. How about that? Yeah. But that situation, that whole situation with that guy. What was his name? I don't remember. But yeah, that was gnarly. Not really. I can't imagine what it would be to be in Cassandra's place. But again, I can't imagine what it would be to be in his place. Just, you know, being disfigured and all. I don't know. Anyway, that's gonna be it for now. And, well, if you'll join me for the next one, we are gonna see, we're gonna go on a pilgrimage or whatever. Kalaka Shrine. We are gonna go there. We're gonna go there. Yeah, that's quite interesting. Look at that. A painted skull. Huh. Premonitions. Premonitions. For now, I'm Colonel RPG, and this has been Hard West. I really hope you've enjoyed it, even though we didn't have a combat, but it was enjoyable. I enjoyed my time with all the dialogue and the exploration. And if you did enjoy it, please leave a comment down below. Tell me whether or not you're liking the Let's Play. I guess if you're sticking through, I guess you like it. I really hope you have. Like the video if you did. But above all, thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for sticking with me through this Let's Play. And I hope I'll see you next episode. Bye-bye!